And one more woo up in here. Can we get some claps right now going on up in here? Can I get about 3 to 5 steps forward if you would like to, if that is comfortable with you, just to get a little closer in here so we can have a little aura and some environment around us right now. I want to thank everybody. I would say good morning, but now is not a time to mourn. Yesterday is not a time to mourn. There is no sadness. Right here, what you see is people rising together and shining like the bright sun that we are, showing the true colors of everyone and everything around us. So this right now is a grand rising, not a good morning, family. So I would like to welcome you to Harper's Ferry this morning. My name is Thaddeus, Thad, please, with West Virginia Working Families Party. And we're here this rising to kick off the Freedom to Vote Relay. After caravanning across the state of West Virginia, going from Charleston to Fairmont to Morgantown, Charlestown last night, and here we are in Harper's Ferry today, to bring the message, to bring the clear message back to D.C. that we need the Freedom to Vote Act right now. Yes. To get things started off this morning, let's open up with a quick prayer from Reverend Derek Biondi.
Thank you so very much. I'm Reverend Derek Biondi, a United Methodist pastor working with Faithful Democracy and the West Virginia Faith Table. Faith voices that are in action to do great things to ensure that every voice is heard. I invite you to join me in prayer this morning. Lord, we are here this day, and if we but look around, we see the beauty of this creation. And Lord, it takes our breath away. But Lord, in the midst of the beauty of this creation, there are ugly things as well. And so, Lord, you have put us to work. You have put us to walking. You have put us to biking. Lord, may our feet carry us where you guide us. And Lord, be with our leaders, that nothing may stop every voice from being heard, because, Lord, you hear every single voice. We pray this all in the name of the one who gave so much for us. Amen.
Now to introduce our first speaker, this brother came by Beckley, West Virginia. He said, man, I want to bring the Freedom Ride folks through Beckley, West Virginia. I said, Beckley, West Virginia? You ever heard of Beckley, West Virginia? He said, no, I know about Appalachia. I also know a little something about them Appalachians y'all got up there too. And y'all know how to turn things up and get things done right. So I would like to introduce you to our first speaker here today, this morning, Cliff Albright with Black Voters Matter. Everybody, please give a warm welcome to my brother Cliff. Thanks, man. Hey, good morning, everybody. When I say Black Voters, you say Matter. Black Voters
Matter.
Black Voters
Matter.
When I say Love, you say Power. Love.
Power.
Love.
Power.
When I say Freedom, you say To Vote. Freedom.
To Vote.
Freedom.
To Vote.
Y'all, I'm so excited to be here with you all today. So many incredible organizations, Working Families Party, Faithful Democracy, DFAT. Got my fam from Georgia People's Coalition out here, People's Agenda out here. And just so many organizations, individuals that are out here. And this is what it's all about, y'all. When we always do that chant, y'all know how it goes. Show me what democracy looks like.
This is what democracy looks like.
This is what it looks like. And we're out here in historic Harper's Ferry. First, let's give it up to the folks that started off the relay yesterday with that incredible caravan throughout West Virginia. And this is day 2, and I'm going to keep it short because I need all my time to get these 60 miles in. So, yeah, we need to leave on time because I would need that time. But we are here demanding the Freedom Vote and demanding the Freedom Vote Act, as well as the John Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act and the D.C. Statehood Act. We need all of our voting rights, not just part of it, all of it. And we don't need it next year. We don't need it 2 years from now. We need it now. And so we are here on the day after a vote, when we saw once again the filibuster being used to squash our voting rights the same way it's been used for over 100 years, primarily to block civil rights legislation.
Ew.
That's right. And so some people might be looking at that and they might be dismayed, right? And they might be afraid. But we are here in historic Harper's Ferry, where we know, where we have learned the lessons that sometimes, even after something that appears to be a loss, sometimes that's just the preface to a victory.
Yeah. Right?
Sometimes when people think that they got you beat, what they don't know is that you got something waiting on the other side. And so I don't care what happened yesterday, because we all know that we're not giving up. And that at the end of the day, we will get voting rights legislation. And so again, I'm excited to be here with you all. I'm going to turn it back over to Thad because we are about to get going on this. Whether you're walking, riding, jogging, driving, whatever you're doing, there is a role for everybody to play. Everybody's got a role to play in this struggle. So if you're watching right now and you've not yet get involved, guess what? It ain't too late.
That's
you
right.
can still get on the train
That's
and
right.
get on the caravan and get on this victory. Thank y'all.
Thank
you so much for that, Cliff. Just transitioning to make sure that we keep the blood going and make sure we get this thing in a nice little schedule event. I'd like to transition over here to Rev Lene to speak and give us a couple of words. Thank you.
Friends, the spirit of prophetic citizenship is with you and also with me.
Yes.
The spirit of prophetic citizenship is with you
and also with you.
Friends, I am here today to do just a small bit of mourning, just a small bit, to mourn with you that America's covenant is broken.
That's right.
We have a basic covenant in this country. Self-evident truths that all men and women and non-binary folks are created equal and endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights. That is our basic covenant in this country, and I mourn with you today that our covenant is broken. In the church, we call it like this. Each one of us is created in the image of God. A divine imprint on your soul, on mine, in your mind and mine, on your body and mine. And because of that divine imprint, we are not just invited to discern on our own the wisdom of the universe for our own small lives. We are actually required as a moral obligation, each one of us individually to discern divine wisdom for the well-being of the community. It is an actual obligation, not just something a governing body can pass and say you got it or you don't.
That's right.
This is a divine requirement.
That's right.
That you and I and all of us together discern divine wisdom for the good of the whole. That covenant, friends, has been broken. So we do a little bit of mourning. It is, in fact, mourning. But we are not without hope, friends.
Right.
We are not without hope. We know that through hard work and a whole lot of grace and a whole lot more work and a whole lot of grace,
That's right.
Covenants can be restored.
Yes.
And that's what we're about today. And thank goodness for every one of you getting ready to get on that bike to go to the house of power and say power belongs to the people.
That's right.
Power belongs to the ones who have been given that God-given, not just right, but responsibility to discern wisdom for the good of the whole.
That's right.
So we are not without hope today. In fact, we are full of hope. We are full of conviction. We are full of what we call prophetic citizenship. Friends, the spirit of prophetic citizenship calls us to act for justice. The spirit of prophetic citizenship calls us to go into those halls of power and say, your job, friends, is to make sure we can do our job.
That's right.
So, friends, in the spirit of prophetic citizenship, your sleeves are already rolled up, your sunscreen's on, get the bike helmets ready, and let's get riding. Thanks, friends.
Thank you so much for that. The next person we're going to have up here is a very true testament of going to those people, talking to those people, and giving them the platform to be what they want to do. This is one half of the Great Road Show of Zad, Zach, and Thad. We're a wonderful road show. We always come together. So I'd like to be able to introduce you today to Zach Shrewsbury with Common Defense.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Zach Shrewsbury. I'm the lead organizer of Common Defense. We're the nation's largest progressive organization. I'm also a native West Virginian, and I fully understand the need for voting access that the Freedom to Vote Act provides. So oftentimes you hear about veterans who come back from overseas or experience traumas while in the military. Yet you don't really understand the full impact of how things such as voting are affected. Many veterans can't stand in line due to injuries or severe knee and back pain.
That's right.
Many veterans can't handle the crowd due to PTSD, which makes early voting absolutely necessary. Which under Senator Manchin, we've had that protection. And thanks to Senator Manchin, he compromised, made the Freedom to Vote Act to ensure we keep our essential freedoms as voting. But yesterday, the Washington Republicans in the Senate shot down that bill, spitting in the face of all Americans and American veterans. Now here in West Virginia, we have to watch as a Republican supermajority carve up our state like some jigsaw puzzle of poverty. Mm-hmm. Frankly, it's disgusting to witness. Now we are at Hoppers Ferry this morning, the place where John Brown took his last stand. I want to quote him here stating, "These men are all talk, what is needed is action." That's 100% what we need is action. We can't sit idly by and watch this state be cut up and sold. We can't sit idly by as we watch and allow Washington fat cat politicians obstruct our democracy.
Right.
It's time to fight back against these radicals in office. It's time to organize and take actions as West Virginians. It's time to awaken our people's history and organize, organize, organize. Our community's survival depends upon it. As a veteran, I'm going to continue my service to this nation by never stopping, never quitting. The fight is on, folks. Our voting rights, our basic foundation, is in imminent danger. The Freedom to Vote Act isn't something that a bunch of January 6ers can toy with. It's necessary legislation for Americans. I'm taking action. We are taking action. It's time for everyone to stand up and defend your republic, defend your voice. Stay in the fight, West Virginia. Thank you.
Now to introduce one of the last speakers, I'm happy to be able to present to you Reverend Ronald English. Yeah. Reverend English is licensed and ordained into the ministry by the immortal leader and guidance of Drs. Martin Luther King Jr. and Sr. at Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta, Georgia. And in 1972, Reverend English was called to the First Baptist Church of Charleston, West Virginia. We are so honored and glad to have you join us today at this historical place of Harpers Ferry, continuing to fight this historic fight for civil rights. I give you Reverend English, everyone.
I'm more than delighted, I'm excited and ignited to be here. And I'm glad for those that came before me because they kind of gave me a couple of ideas and inspiration in the moment. First of all, I want to say to the last speaker, thank you for your service.
That's right. Thank you.
Thank you for your service. And then when somebody said that this was a relay, I remember in high school I did participate in 440 relay and one or two others. And what made the relay work is that you had to pass the baton and place it in the hand of the one that takes it from where you leave off. And I feel that that is a lot of baton movement, placement, and strategically handling between how it moves from one to the other. And that's what teamwork is about. And that's what I'm feeling in this place, that there is a sense of teamwork and connection that is making it worth the run. No matter what the outcome, it's already in here. Old folk used to talk about something on the inside working on the outside. So that whenever there's anything working on the outside, on the inside, then we got to find the resource and the source for continuing that kind of momentum for passing the baton until the race is done. And so I appreciate how that image and what you are talking about doing is represented by your presence here today. And there are some runners that are young, there are some runners in the middle, there are some runners like me who can maybe be there to cheer on the baton. But take delight in being a part of the team. And so that's the first thing that really struck me about being here today, that there is a relay going on and everybody has a part in it, and just passing the baton from one generation to the next. Then the other is, somebody talked about the mourning and regretting that she had to mourn. Well, I believe that this movement also is about moving from mourning, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, to mourning, M-O-R-N-I-N-G. And one goes with the other, because mourning is something that you do because you are feeling that something is past. Someone has passed. There is some memory that seemed to be lost. There is something that causes a sadness. But if we don't have some sense of mourning, then we don't know how to arrive at mourning. In other words, when it is darkest, you see the light. And when when the dawn is coming, and when the dawn is breaking, there's night behind it, but there's sun above it. And so that's how you literally see how the movement goes from mourning to mourning. And that's how we have something to celebrate every day. That we get up and say, good morning, y'all.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. There are three things that come to mind, and very briefly, in terms of being here today. I'm delighted to be at Harpers Ferry, because when I heard the invitation, I was going to be here anyway, because of what this space and place means to African Americans, and for what the voices around here feel. And there's a sense of that presence of John Brown's rage. But there's also a sense of that presence of W.E.B. Du Bois.
Yes.
W.E.B. Du Bois. Niagara Movement.
Yes.
And in the second meeting of the Niagara Movement, which was the birth of the NAACP, I'm proud to be president of and kind of servant leader in that capacity. But in that second speech at the second gathering of the Niagara Movement, he said the first order of business was to get to vote. Was to get to vote. Because it was vital in that time just to have the right to vote, because folks got lynched on the way to the polls. That was a tragedy just in terms of standing up and thinking about you wanted to get the right to vote. That was the context in which he was speaking, that this has to be our first order of business. And that's how the fiber of where we stand today was begun, in terms of the Niagara Movement on this spot, in this place, and where we hear those voices still in the air and in our hearts and minds and spirits. So had to be here. And old folks used to say, glad to be in the number. One more time. One more time. Other thing that comes to mind is how we have to recognize that a part of how we move from disgrace to dignity, how we move from understanding that when it is darkest we see the stars, means that every moment of our involvement has a message in the minute. One of the things that I was really glad to be a part of is how I could feel the energy that would show up in this group in the moment. because in this moment, I got a feeling everything is going to be all right. Yeah. I mean, some of y'all might have heard about this book called The Power of Now. You know, that means that in any given moment, you can say it's all good. Anything that we're worried about is because of something that we anticipate going to be wrong tomorrow or that we brought from yesterday. But when you look around right now, you can look around and say, it's all good. Look at somebody and say, you know what? It's all good. It's just good to be here because it is all good. And therefore, that gives you energy in the moment to stand not only on your ground and what you are grounded in, but in terms of communing with the ancestors, because that's where they speak. They speak in the moment. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus far on our way, thou who has by thy light led us into the light, keep us forever in the path, we pray. Keep in the moment, pass the baton. Be delighted that we are moving from mourning to mourning. Listen to the voices that are within us and listen to the voices that are around us. The last thing that I had written down here is to give thanks for the invitation, but also to acknowledge we basically in every NAACP meeting, there are ways that we decide on three things. And really it's the way that we get the business done. We ask the first question we ask is, what's up? Literally, that means what's up? Because when we get kind of bogged down in times like this, we forget to ask, what's up? We talk about what's down.
Yeah.
Ask yourself, what's up? Because that's where the energy comes and the power of now to get on with the business of the day. What's up? All right? So whenever we have a time of meeting, then start off by asking, what's up? Then the next question you ask is, what now? What now? What now? And that gives us a chance to survey where we are, what we are about, and where we go from there. So what's up, what now, then what next? So that is a connection between the three. You start with what the affirmation is that we can make in the present moment, rather than bringing a lot of sadness and grief, and we know that it is there, but we find some resource within us so that we can become a resource to somebody else. And when that is a resource exchange, there's some power going on. And it's like the resource exchange in the group in terms of what has brought you here this morning. Lastly, we have been encouraged, we have been trying to be encouraging to Senator Manchin on a couple of occasions when we met with him. NAACP presidents met, George Rutherford was there, and it seemed like that meeting went pretty good, and that was something that was really helping in terms of how he was giving responses then. But there are two things that I have had, one is when you talk about filibuster. I was surprised that the racist history of the filibuster was not known. He was not aware of the racist history of filibuster because, see, I came from down south, down further south. And when I was growing up, the filibuster was used by the Dixiecrats to oppose everything that even looked like civil rights legislation. And it was done consistently. And I believe that James Eastland is still the one who has the record for speaking the longest on the filibuster. If they bring the filibuster out back, they at least ought to have, you have to show up the filibuster.
Yes. Yes.
So when you do it long distance, then that means you really haven't put anything in.
Really, yes.
But you have taken something out. So I hope that if we have to deal with it in that way, then at least you have to show up to be counted rather than a long distance delay because either of laziness or you just too much involved in something else. But I think that if you had to sweat on the floor to defend your position, I think it would make a little bit more difference in terms of what kind of energy you were able to sustain for the blockage that you want to present. So part of what I hope at least will be more of a upfront event that would make a difference is something happening with the filibuster, because it has been a tool that has been in the basket too long. In fact, I really was part of the conversation I had with the senator. Said, Senator, now if the concern is that one party will use it when it's in power and another party will use it when it's in power, I said, well, if it's an evil tool in the box, if it's a tool in the box for that use, then why not take the damn thing out the box? Then nobody can use it. But it's going to take a while before we get there. But that issue about the filibuster is something that will loom larger now, I believe, in light of the fact of where we see it has drained us and has stained us in terms of where we go from here. Last but not least, I heard Dr. King preach more than I heard him speak. And one of the things that I remember most, one of the things was a story that they always told about how he was on the way to the airport late night for a flight, and his driver was on a two-lane road, and the guy that kept coming, drivers kept coming, kept their headlights blaring on the high beam. Driver said, Doc, I'm tired of that. The next time that somebody comes blaring at me with their high beams, I'm going to keep my high beams on so they can see what it feels like. Doc said, no, you can't do that. Because somebody got to have some sense on this road. Part of what you are saying, we are saying, that in spite of all the craziness that is going on, somebody got to have some sense on this road.
Yes. That's right. Yes. Yep.
Yeah. Turn to somebody and say, you know what? We got to keep some sense on this road.
Yes.
We got some difficult days ahead, but we got to keep some sense on this road.
Yes.
Keep hope alive. Last thing, Dr. King has often been misquoted by saying that it's always right to do the right thing. No, he didn't say that. He said it's always right to do right. Mm-hmm. Because he also put it in the context of saying, and I close with this, he said that there are certain critical moments when you have to make a critical decision. And in those kinds of moments where the impact is so great and where the stakes are large, in those kind of moments of critical decision, where we are now, and where our senator is now, cowardness asks, is it safe? Vanity asks, is it popular? Politics asks, is it expedient? conscience asks, is it right?
Yeah, that's right.
And therefore, there are some things we don't do because they are popular, because they are expedient, but because they are right.
That's right.
And it, in that sense that he says, it's always right to do right. And I want to make that clear, because he didn't say it's time to do the right thing, because that means that right becomes a modifier of the noun thing. No. When he says it's always right to do right, right stands on its own.
Yes. That's right. Yes.
And so we keep our energy grounded in the confidence that whatever we are doing, it is because we know it is right.
That's right.
We are on the right side of history.
Yes.
We are on the right cause.
Yes.
We are in the right place.
That's right.
At the right time.
That's right.
Keep hope alive.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for that powerful speech, Reverend English, talking about doing the right thing. Do the right thing, too. Spike Lee and Joe Manchin coming out this Christmas. Gonna do the right thing right now. I was in Ben's acapella, and this is a really good time to sing. But doing the right thing, I'm not gonna sing. So I'm gonna give it to Lucia Valentine, who is a really great singer. Lucia, if you could offer us your voice, Zach, take that song. Oh, thank you, Julie. Come on, Lucia, give us some vibrations. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, guys. It's beautiful to be here with you all this morning, and feel free to sing or clap along. Woke up this morning with my mind set on freedom. Woke up this morning with my mind set on freedom. I woke up this morning with my mind set freedom, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm walking and talking with my mind set on freedom, walking and talking with my mind set on freedom. I'm walking and talking with my mind set on freedom. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
All right, ain't nothing ending. It's just now getting started. It is just now getting started. What do we say when I say freedom? You say to vote. Freedom.
To vote.
Freedom.
To vote.
All right, now listen. I know we're talking about a Voting Rights Act bill, but they might have to put the infrastructure bill back in after we done relaying and marching. Ain't that right, people? Ain't that right? We're going to be doing the right thing. So I am so glad that we are here together. I'm so glad that we are taking control of the narrative together. Thank you once again to Joe Manchin for keeping the code on message. And we're going to stay on code right now through this wall. So I would like to give it to Miss Akine so she can give you all the proper directions and instructions to what to do on the relay. And we're going to do this together. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much. That was so beautiful. And I'm not supposed to speak, but I just got to say, if we have a vote for every American, every voice is heard, we have a democracy that works, that means we can be free, we can love each other, we can live in love. It means so much. It means so much. It means to be free, to be who you are fully in this country and have a government that really represents you. That's what we all deserve.
Yes. That's right.
All right, so I'm going to walk us through this relay. My name is Akane Freechild. I'm a public citizen, one of the many, many groups that's part of the Declaration Coalition here today. So if you are taking photos and video here, please use the hashtag #FreedomToVoteRelay. That's #FreedomToVoteRelay. At 3 o'clock today, they're gonna be collecting all of the posts from yesterday and today and amplifying them across the coalition and more than 200 groups. So please post before, like 1 o'clock would be great, or 2 o'clock, with your photos and videos so that people can see. They're not able to be here. You guys made a huge sacrifice to be here, taking off of work, being away from your families. We've got folks from Florida, Georgia, Connecticut, all over. So make sure they know you're here by posting out on all the channels, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. So I'm gonna walk us through. We're gonna get started after we take a picture. So after I'm done talking, we're all gonna come around the signs and get a photo, and we might move you around a little bit if the lighting needs to change. Get a photo, bring your bikes, make sure that they aren't blocking anybody. And then we're gonna line up, walkers first behind the banner, bikes after so everybody can read the banner and we can see the walkers. So we're gonna line up close to that sign and that lamppost there so we can walk across the bridge together. Then we're gonna let the bikes go ahead. We know that they're fast. We're gonna let those runners go ahead if we got any runners here at this point. But when we'll be able to get photos of you crossing the bridge, and then you can run ahead on the bikes. So we're gonna get to Brunswick is our first stop. Every single stop, you have a wonderful team of support folks. We're gonna have Gatorade, they're gonna have water, they're gonna have all of your favorite snacks, we hope. Other things you need, first aid kit. We'll have a few bike tools. Hope you brought some too in your flat kit. And if you need help, there is a guide like this on the table for every relay participant. It has every single stop. It has a little map of where the support team is going to be, where people can park to pick you up. All the good things are in here. There's two phone numbers at the top. For Charlie and Joan, they are the dispatchers. If you have a bike issue you can't fix and you need the bike guy to come and find you on the trail, call Charlie and Joan. If you fell and you need a Band-Aid, not an ambulance, call 911 if you need an ambulance. If you need a Band-Aid or something and your walk marshal doesn't have one, call Charlie and Joan. If you need a ride, call Charlie and Joan. They will get you to the right person. So if you don't have this packet or you don't have those numbers, you can grab one. You can take a picture of those numbers. They're right on the front of the packet. All right. So we're going to kick off from here shortly, take a picture, start walking. We're going to get to Brunswick. If you are coming back from Brunswick to West Virginia, you're going to wait for at Beans in the Belfry coffee shop. There's some good snacks and things there, and wait for a shuttle with Morgan. Morgan, you want to raise your hand real quick? If people are coming back to West Virginia, you're shuttling.
I don't think anybody is.
Nobody? Okay, all right. So, but people can wait for the shuttle if you're walking forward on the trail at Beans in the Belfry, which is a coffee shop. It's like a block off the trail, a block and a half. There's a shuttle with Kim at West Virginia Elite Excursions. If you need Kim, you can call Charlie and Joan. They're your people. So they'll be taking walkers from Brunswick. There may be new walkers at Brunswick, but walkers who are tired after the first 7 miles, which we appreciate, will shuttle you on the West Virginia Elite Excursion Shuttle to Point of Rocks. So after Brunswick, it's Point of Rocks. Bikers are going to get there early. Stop in Point of Rocks, get yourself fed, be back at Point of Rocks for the amazing press conference of the League of Women Voters. And the Maryland Sarah Club and all these wonderful groups are putting on Black Voters Matter. Cliff is going to be speaking again from there. So, and lots of other great folks. So make sure you're at that press conference. We should all represent. We're here for the cause. And then at 1 o'clock, we'll restart walkers and bikers again. All right. So 1 o'clock, the shuttle will also be there to take people back to West Virginia if they need to get their car. All right. So walkers can then walk from Point of Rocks to Nolens Ferry and get picked up again by the shuttle and get shuttled to Angler's Access. So there's tons and tons of stops in between there. At Angler's Access, so walkers start again. There'll be more people joining to finish out the day at Glen Echo Park. Glen Echo Park is really, we're just going to have a warm welcome there, but it is really important. It was desegregated by Harvard students over a year-long campaign. It was a huge civil rights fight, so please remember that and share that information as you're sharing photos. All right. I was going to go over the rest, but hopefully folks will join us again. If anybody can join us tomorrow, we're starting at 1:30 at Glen Echo again, going all the way to Ben's Chili Bowl for a shindig and on U Street in Washington, D.C. And then Thad is going to be running us home for the very last mile to the relay on Saturday at 11:30 outside the U.S. Capitol to pass the baton. So some of the teams have batons. If you want a baton, come find me. If you have a bike or need a bike, Justin Kwasa from the League of Conservation Voters, the co-convener of this event, has a U-Haul. You can put your bike in. If you get hurt or your bike gets messed up or you need help, he's got a call Charlie and Joan or talk to him right now if you want to get his number if you have a bike or need a bike. And then Morgan's got an announcement, and then we're going to take a picture so everybody can start moving this way. Just real quick, if you guys aren't going on the relay or you're looking for an action to take today, you can text the words free vote to the number 30403. Again, that's the words free vote to the number 30403. And what that's going to do, it's going to immediately text you. And then when you type ready, it's going to call you directly to Senator Joe Manchin. It's going to give you a message, a sample message of language that you can use on that voicemail to him, asking him to pass the Freedom to Vote Act. So again, if you're looking for action to take today and you're not going on the relay, or maybe you are and you're going to stop for lunch, feel free to text the words free vote to the number 304, just like our area code in West Virginia, 30403. Thanks so much, and let's go take our pictures. Thank you.
Okay. I'm trying to finish and it won't finish.